Good morning. Welcome to our worship service today. I do hope all of you had a wonderful Christmas. It's so good to see all of you here today. And let's begin by standing and singing our opening hymn, There Is a Song in the Air.
concluded as we pray together, the prayer printed in your bulletin. Let us pray. Holy Father, God of our yesterdays, our today, and our tomorrows, thank you for the year behind us and for the year ahead. Help us in your new year, Father, to fret less and laugh more, to teach our children to laugh by laughing with them, to teach others to love by loving them. Help us, Father, to hear your love song in every sunrise, in the chirping of sparrows in our backyards, in the stories of our old folks and the fantasies of our children. Help us to stop and listen to these love songs so that we may know you better and better. Thank you for another new year and for the new chances every day. Forgive us for falling short this past year. We leave the irreparable past in your hands and step out into the unknown new year, knowing you will go with us. We accept your gift of a new year, and we rejoice in what's ahead, depending on you to help us do exactly what you want. In Jesus' name, amen. May we continue now with a few moments of personal prayer and meditation. Dear Heavenly Father, let us be confident in knowing that you hear our prayers this day. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. Please stand if you are able as we affirm our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended in the heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Lord be with you. Let us be seated as we pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to gather today as your church. We ask you to be with each one here and those we love who may not be here with us today. We pray for the leaders of St. John's in our community and our country. We ask for your guidance as this year ends and we begin a new one. Father, bring peace and healing to our community and those around our country who have experienced tragedies. Please be with the families who have lost loved ones and with those who serve in police and fire departments, and with them as they risk their lives daily to protect us. Help us to remember the birth of your Son, which we just celebrated, and may Jesus always serve as our example as we live each day. We pray that the Mission Impact Celebration in January at St. John's will open our hearts and minds to those who may not know you and to those who take your message out to the world. We ask that you keep the men and women who work as missionaries all over our world and in our community safe, and ask that those who hear them will be open to the message of Christ's love. Thank you, Lord, for this new day. Help us to be worthy of your love in all we do. Let us now pray together the prayer that Jesus has taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
I do want to remind you that at the end of January, we will have our annual MIC celebration. This year, most of our missionaries will be home on leave, and we welcome them. We are excited about that. And also, on Thursday evening, our bishop, our new bishop that was installed in September, will be present with us here. So this is an opportunity for us to meet old friends and new friends as well. Now, I also want to remind you as you leave to pick up your Missions Impact Celebration daily devotional. We want you to pray for our missionaries, for our mission, and everything that we do every single day. And then there's going to be a time of prayer in the chapel for all of us on January the 6th, January 13th, and January the 20th from 8:30 to 12. The chapel will be open, and we invite you to come in and pray there as well. I really do believe that this is going to be one of our greatest years in mission, and I appreciate your prayers and your thoughts. At this time, we invite the ushers to come forward to receive your tithes and offerings. And as they come, please remember the ritual of friendship pad and let us know of your presence today. And also, we are delighted to have with us Lauren Norton, who is leading us in our singing. If Lauren was not here, you'd have to listen to me. And so we welcome her today. There will be no children's church today, even though there is a nursery provided for the younger children. Let us now sing our next hymn, Love Came Down at Christmas. remain standing for the reading of the gospel lesson. It comes from Luke chapter 2, verses 41 and following. Now every year his parents went to Jerusalem for the festival of the Passover, and when he was 12 years old, they went up as usual for the festival. And when the festival was ended, they started to return. The boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem, but his parents did not know it. Assuming that he was in the group of the travelers, they went a day's journey. Then they started to look for him among their relatives and friends. And when they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem to search for him. And after 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. And when his parents saw him, they were astonished. And his mother said to him, "Child," can you hear her? "Child, why have you treated us like this? Look, your father and I have been searching for you in great anxiety." He said to them, "Why were you searching for me? Did you not know that I must be in my father's house?" But they did not understand what he said to them. And then he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was obedient to them. His mother treasured all these things in his heart. And Jesus increased in wisdom and in years and in divine and human favor. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. The first sermon I ever preached, I was sitting on the front row. The church sang 3 hymns, an anthem, took up the offering. And it was only about 12 minutes after 11. And then came the time for me to read the scripture and preach the sermon. Well, by the time I finished reading my scripture, it was about 11:15. Right now, it's 10:18. And so, being my first sermon, I thought that I had to fill up the hour. And I preached my sermon. It was about 25 after. So I preached my sermon again. And then I preached my sermon the third time. And then I extended the invitation. And then finally we came to the hymn, and I said, "Whew, finally, I made it." It was close enough to 12, I could end the service. When it was over, the music director came up to me and said, "George, that was a great sermon the first time." I understood a little more the second time, but I forgot it all the third time. Someone said this morning, "George, be quick. We got places to go today." So, I promise you, it won't be all that long today. When Jesus was born, there were a lot of people looking for a Savior. In fact, this was the national obsession. The people of Israel understood that their only hope was that God would send them a Savior to rescue them from their darkness. And did you notice how few people recognized when the Savior came? Oh, the shepherds knew it. The wise men knew it. Mary and Joseph knew it. But almost everyone else missed it. The innkeeper missed it. Herod missed it. Why, the entire nation missed it. And there they were, never realizing that God had made a decision to leave his throne in heaven and to visit earth, to live with us, to be one of us. You would think, under such circumstances, that God would have wanted to let everyone know of his presence. That he would have made a bigger splash than coming to us as a mere human being, born as a baby to peasant parents in a town called Bethlehem of all places. No wonder the whole world missed it. Yet that's the way God came. He came to us vulnerable. He came to us unannounced. He came to us as a child. Why did God choose to come to us this way? Did he come to be hidden? No, I think God came to us this way so that we might discover who he was, that we might know him. And if God came to us as a child, what would prevent God from coming to us? And if God was born in a manger, what would prevent God from coming and being born in us today? You know, God came this way so that we might know him, know that he cares, know that he loves, knows that he loves you, know that he loves me, know that he loves everyone. God came so that we could recognize who he was. Did you find Jesus this Christmas? Pam and I had been married for a short period of time, and we went to visit her uncle. Now, her uncle is an interesting character. He loves to tell stories. He loves to laugh. And we just enjoyed our time there. We went traveling from different places. And when it came time to leave, Pam and I were traveling down the road. And we were 5 or 6 miles away from her uncle's house when suddenly we looked at each other and realized we had left the other car. How do you forget something so important? We left a car. And do you know how embarrassing it was to travel those 5 or 6 miles back to her uncle's house? Why, he's been telling that story for almost 30 years. Mary and Joseph had gone to the festival of the Passover. And Jesus went for the first time. He was 12 years old. He was now a man. And when it came time to leave, Mary and Joseph headed back toward Nazareth. And they traveled a day's journey before they realized that Jesus was missing. Now, don't be too hard on Mary and Joseph. I left a car. You see, back in those days, men and women didn't travel together. And so Joseph probably assumed that Jesus was with Mary, and Mary probably assumed that Jesus was with Joseph. And when they got together that evening, he was missing, and they started searching and looking everywhere. 3 days they looked and they searched, and they finally found him. Where? In God's house. Have you ever been searching for something and it found you? Now, this has happened to me on many occasions, and I'm certain it's happened to some of you. I was looking for my glasses. I was late for work, and I looked everywhere, in the familiar places and the unfamiliar places. Why, I turned that house upside down. I was getting frantic, and then suddenly I calm myself down. I think, and my glasses find me. Jesus said, why Were you searching for me? Didn't you know where I would be? In my Father's house? I was never lost. I was always right here in God's house. Now, if you're looking for God, if you're searching for Jesus, where would you find him? Where would you look? You see, God made a fateful decision on that first Christmas Eve. No longer do we have to search for God. God is already here, searching for you and for me. Where did you find God this Christmas? Well, I first found him this Christmas on December the 2nd when our children sang at the children's musical. Did you ever realize we had so many children? And did you realize that we had so many children and youth that were so talented? Why, they can sing almost as good as I can. They were absolutely amazing. And in the midst of all of their singing, I saw the joy, I saw the happiness. And there I found God. No, there God found me. And I was just swept away. I found God at the cantata. Oh, that was so inspiring, wasn't it? So deeply moving. Why, we were inspired and swept away, and there in our spirits, we found God. No, God found us. I found God this past Christmas when I read the paper Friday morning. Little Rebecca Moore, one of our church members, she wrote a letter to Santa Claus. And do you know what she asked Santa for? 300 pair of used shoes. Can you imagine a little girl asking for 300 pairs of shoes? And she was very specific. She said, I want 124 pair of boy shoes, 25. I want 125 pair of girl school shoes. And I want 50 pair of little baby shoes. Now, when she woke up on Christmas morning, she didn't find 300 pair of shoes. She found 600 pairs of shoes. And her greatest joy was not in receiving all kinds of presents from Santa. No. Her favorite joy was the joy of those who didn't have shoes and that she could give it to them and see the joy on their face. You know where I found God this Christmas? I found him on Christmas Eve at the 5 o'clock service, the children's service. You've never heard more crying babies in your life. It was chaotic. It was not a quiet, sweet little Christmas Eve service. No, these children were so excited. And when they came down and I was trying to tell the Christmas story, I couldn't tell the Christmas story because there was this little boy jumping up and down and up and down and up and down and playing with his sister. Listen, folks, I wish you and I were as excited about Jesus coming to us as those children were on Christmas Eve. And where will you find God in 2013? I see a lot of storm clouds on the sky and in the horizon. Economic insecurity. Here we are on the very edge of the physical cliff. We wonder if there is going to be something done before tomorrow night. I mean, we are right on the edge of plumbing off. And how are we going to survive that economic storm if it happens? And for some of you, I see storms of health and issues and loss and grief. Where are you going to be in 2013 when the storms hit you? And where will you find God? Or will you be like most of those people who came on Christmas? You know, those who say goodbye to the baby Jesus and he's in the rearview mirror and we don't see those folks again till Easter when the little baby's grown up and is resurrected from the dead. And then they forget about him until Christmas. Where will you find Jesus this year? You see, those are the people when the storms hit, question and say, where is God? Where are you going to be when the storms hit? Well, folks, here's some things you can do in 2013 to find God. I think the best place you can find God is in God's house. That's where I'm going to be. Well, I have to be. I mean, that's my job. There's no better place for you to find God than right here when the storms hit. You know, when I come to church, I feel a spirit. I feel a power. I feel the presence of God. We aren't searching for God. God's right here searching for you and for me. And this is the place where you can find Him. Where are you going to be when the storms hit? You know, I looked through the scriptures in preparing this sermon for a time when Jesus was missing. And there's a lot of stories in the New Testament of when Jesus was missing. But on this one story, Jesus had just fed the 5,000. He dismissed the crowds. He sent the disciples away on a boat to cross on the other side of the Sea of Galilee. He went up into a mountain to pray, and there he was all by himself. Now, in the middle of the night, there came this storm. And the winds and the waves were contrary to the disciples. And there they were in the middle of the sea, fighting for their very life. And then, in the fourth watch of the night, not the first watch, not the second watch, not the third watch, in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus comes and walks to them on the water. And when the disciples first saw Jesus, they were afraid, thinking it was a ghost. And Jesus said, "Don't be afraid, it's me." And Peter said, "Lord, if it's you, then bid me to come to you." And he said, "Come." And Peter, he stepped out of that boat and he started walking on the water like he was walking on dry ground. And then suddenly he was distracted. He was distracted by the winds and the waves. And he began to sink. And Jesus reached down and grabbed his hand and picked him up and said, "Peter, when are you going to believe in me? Ye of such little faith. When are you going to believe in me when all the storms hit in your life? When are you going to trust me, Peter?" You know, I want to believe in Jesus in 2013. I want to trust Him more than I've ever trusted Him. And when the storms come and I'm sinking, folks, I'm going to reach out and grab hold of the hand of Jesus, because I certainly don't want to hold on to the hand of this world. Washington's not in charge. Wall Street's not in charge. You're not in charge. God's in charge. And folks, I want to hold His hand. I want to believe in Him more in 2013. I want to be more generous. I want to be more generous with my time. Parents, there's no better thing for you to do than to be generous with your time, with your children. And I know you're trying to get up that economic ladder, and you're trying to save and provide for your children and provide for your future and all of this, but I got news for you. The best investment you can make of your time is with your children. Get off the iPhone. Get off the iPad. Get off the iPod. Stop answering the emails. Parents, do you know that you can't even talk to your children today unless you text them? They don't even know how to talk to each other, much less know how to talk with you. Turn it off and talk to each other. One of the greatest things you can do in 2013 is to be generous with your time. with your children and with others. Also, be more generous in your giving. You know, that's who I want to trust with my giving, because he's the best investment you will ever, ever make. And finally, in 2013, I want to be more gracious, even with crying babies. I want to be so gracious, because you know, you can live a bitter life, can't you? I've seen people like that. They live bitter, selfish lives. Nothing's always right. Everything is wrong. You know what? I want to be more gracious in 2013. I want to be more loving. I want to be more kind. I want to be more forgiving. I want to be more gracious. You know, if you do those few things, I know for certain you won't have to go searching for God, because God's already found you. Was that quick enough? I do hope and pray that you have a wonderful new year, and everywhere you go, God finds you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.